all of us back on the 64th issue of the DigiConnect webinars. Today is a special day. Just before the Independence Day, we are having two of our own internal esteemed speakers who would be taking us through the session. But before we begin the session, let me invite the president of AEOHT, Dr. Gajen Kumar, to introduce the speakers. Dr. Gajen?
Sir, he is joining in a minute, sir.
All right, so maybe we just give the participants a minute more.
Good evening.
He has joined.
Good evening, Dr. Sudha.
Yeah, he has joined, sir.
Good evening, Dr. Gajen. So it's great to have all of us together. And Dr. Gajen, I just began by saying that today we are going to have some two great internal speakers, internal experts. Can I have the privilege of you doing the opening and introducing the speakers, Dr. Gajen?
Good evening, friends. Today is a very auspicious day on the eve of independence. We are all meeting again. And today we have got two esteemed speakers from our own organization, Dr. Sandeep Sharma and Dr. R.K. Jain. And both of them shall be speaking on very, very important topics. Dr. Sandeep Sharma shall be discussing on the issue of living with the invisible, because now onward we all have to learn how to live with this coronavirus. And Dr. R.K. Jain will update all of us on the epidemiological aspect of COVID-19. So with these few words, I welcome both the speakers. I welcome all the participants to this program. Thank you. Dr. Ashish?
Thanks a lot, Dr. Gajen. And I think while all of us are really aware about the credentials of both of the esteemed speakers, to begin with, let me first invite Dr. Rajiv Jain to share the COVID-19 updates. Dr. Rajiv is a senior consultant health in the Indian Railways. He has more than 40 years of experience in health and hospital administration. Dr. Rajiv also has been awarded as a fellow of Indian Public Health Association. He's a fellow of Association of Environmental and Occupational Health, Delhi. Dr. Rajiv has presented and published more than 145 scientific papers all across, and he has several fellowships and scholarships from esteemed organizations, including WHO, the National Institute of Health, from the International Clinical Epidemiology Network. And more recently, he was also being invited and awarded by the Epidemiological Association. So let me hand over this session to Dr. Rajiv. Sir, can you actually take this forward?
Good evening, friends. And greetings for the 75th Independence Day being tomorrow. As we gather every week to review the epidemiological situation of COVID-19, same thing we are doing it today with the hope that we are actually hopeful things are getting under control, but eternal vigilance is the price that everybody who has attained freedom has to pay. Similarly, eternal vigilance is the price for getting freedom from the pandemic of COVID-19. So there is a similarity between COVID-19 pandemic and the freedom struggle. Eternal vigilance and eternal vigilance persistence is what we have to do. Let's see the situation as on date and what is the progress. Let's see the first slide. This slide is showing COVID-19 cases reported weekly by the World Health Organization regions and global deaths. The colors that are shown, they show the regions of the World Health Organization. Now, if you look to the main colored graph, you will find Americas is still contributing a major portion. Europe is also contributing substantially number of cases. Southeast Asia is also substantial, and Eastern Mediterranean has risen in the recent past in its contribution to the global cases. And look at the Western Pacific region. The growth in the Western Pacific region is very high. And definitely the third wave is on globally. If you look at the black line, that black line shows the deaths, and that current wave is the fourth wave of deaths in the world. Because if you recollect, in April, middle last year, was the first wave of deaths. Disproportionate number of deaths, that was the first wave of deaths. If you recollect what was happening in Italy and what was happening in Spain and Europe at that time. So we cannot forget that eternal vigilance is what we have to do throughout, now and in future. Let's see the next slide. This slide shows you the new cases in the last 7 days at percentage. And globally, if we had 42,64,000 cases, the contribution of America's region, which is North America and South America continent, was 33%. Europe continues to contribute 24%. And Southeast Asia region 19%, Eastern Mediterranean 12%, Africa 4%, and Western Pacific region 9%. Now we look at the same data with a different perspective. That is the change in new cases in last 7 days vis-a-vis the previous 7 days. So what we find overall in the world, there has been a rise of 4% in terms of cases, but the highest increase in cases has been in Western Pacific region of the WHO and substantially by Australia. Americas have shown 14% increase. Eastern Mediterranean region has shown 8% increase, while there has been decrease in Europe 7%, Southeast Asia 5%, and Africa 1%. If you look at the new deaths in the last 7 days, out of 65,472 deaths as 100%, the highest contribution of deaths has been by Southeast Asia region, that is 32%, 30% by Americas, and 15% by Europe, 9% by Eastern Mediterranean region, 7% each by Africa and Western Pacific region. Now, if we look at the change in the new deaths in the last 7 days vis-a-vis the previous 7 days, we find there has been a 2% increase in total deaths in the world, out of which 16% increase has been there in Europe, 8% has been there in Eastern Mediterranean, but look at the Western Pacific region. The increase in deaths in Western Pacific region has been 46%. 46% increase in the deaths in the last 7 days in the Western Pacific region of the world. And on the other hand, there have been 4% decrease in the deaths in Americas and 2% decrease in the deaths in Africa region. So what we have is that, again, what we've been saying every week, it's a dynamic situation, and eternal vigilance is the only word we should be coining and speaking again and again today as well. Let's go ahead and see what is the situation in the last 7 days in the regions, the highest contribution. This is the WHO coronavirus dashboard about half an hour back. America's region, 14,84,000 cases out of 44,18,000 cases reported globally. Europe continues to report 11,38,000 cases in the last 7 days. Southeast Asia region, 7,42,000 cases. Eastern Mediterranean region, 4,85,000 cases. Western Pacific region, 4,09,000 cases. And African region, 1,58,000 cases. This is the situation of new cases in the last 7 days as on date. Let's go and see the situation in a different perspective from the country perspective. So which is the largest country? The country which has reported the highest number of cases in the last 7 days. Look at the situation, how dynamically the situation changes every week. What do we find? Out of 44,18,000 cases, the highest number of cases, that is 8,52,000 cases were reported by United States of America. And look at the country at number two position in the world. It is Iran, Islamic Republic of Iran, 2,62,000 cases, which is higher than India or Brazil, which were always standing second, third in the past. India is at third position, 2,61,000 cases. Brazil, 2,80,000 cases. Indonesia, 1,97,000 cases. The United Kingdom, 1,96,000 cases. Turkey, 1,71,000 cases. And Russian Federation, 1,54,000 cases. And France, 1,52,000 cases. And Thailand, 1,48,000 cases. Look at the size of these countries. Thailand, Turkey, Indonesia, and Iran are very small countries, but they are reporting more than 1.5 lakh cases every week. Next slide, we look at the deaths and the countries. The highest number of deaths were reported were from Indonesia. 11,000 deaths out of 66,000 deaths reported in the last 7 days. Brazil reported 6,100 deaths, Russian Federation 5,500 deaths, United States 4,087 deaths, Mexico 3,656 deaths, Iran reported 3,500 deaths, India reported 3,500 deaths, South Africa reported 2,374, Vietnam reported 2,093, and Malaysia reported 1,672. Again, a very, very dynamic situation. It changes, and it is changing forever. Let's go ahead and see more deeper the Southeast Asia region. The Southeast Asia region reported over 7,99,000 new cases, which is a 5% decrease as compared to the previous week. However, several countries in the region continue to report increasing trends, including Sri Lanka and Thailand, which is 26% and 20% increases respectively. Case incidence in the region peaked in early May and has since largely plateaued over the past month. This is largely due to cases in India remaining stable and consistent decreases in Indonesia and Myanmar over the past month. Following a steep increase in the mortality rate in the region, this is the first time in 7 weeks that a decline in the number of new weekly deaths has been reported, a trend largely driven by the declines in the Maldives and Myanmar this week. Large increases in weekly deaths were reported in several countries, including Sri Lanka, Nepal, and Thailand, 47%, 35%, and 30% increases. The highest number of new cases were reported from India, 2,78,631 cases, which is 2% decrease. Indonesia, 2,25,635 new cases, which is 18% decrease. And Thailand, 1,41,000 cases, this is 20% increase. And the highest number of new deaths were reported from Indonesia, 11,373, which is 9% decrease. India reported 3,511 new deaths, which is 8% decrease. And Myanmar reported 2,045 new deaths, which is 22% decrease. And you see the same trend in the figure at the bottom right. Let's go now to the next slide. This slide shows you the phenotypic impact of variants of concern. In Delta, this is the updated position as on date. For Delta, in transmissibility, the increased transmissibility and secondary attack rate, similar transmissibility between vaccinated and unvaccinated individuals. So you must understand, vaccine does not prevent transmission. And there is increased transmissibility and the secondary attack rate. Whether you're vaccinated, unvaccinated, Delta wave has no differentiation. If you look at disease severity and Delta variant, there is increased risk of hospitalization. If you look at risk of reinfection, there is reduction in neutralizing activity in terms of impact on diagnosis. There is no reported change in impact on diagnostics. Let's go and see the next slide. This is the summary of vaccine performance against variants of concern. And if you look at all the vaccines, and especially if you look at number two on the top, that is AstraZeneca. For Delta, there is protection retained against severe disease, possible reduced protection against symptomatic disease, an infection and limited evidence. This is what is the summary. Severe disease, as you see, there is a horizontal line. Symptomatic disease, there is decrease, and infection, there is single decrease. Neutralization, there is 1 to 2 decrease. And if we look at the other vaccine of our concern, that we find the Covishield is the same as AstraZeneca. Let's go. And if you find the fourth row from the left, the Bharat Covaxin is showing the neutralization is same. If you look at Delta, the severe disease, there's no evidence. Symptomatic disease, there's decrease, but less than AstraZeneca. But for infection, there is no evidence at the moment. Next, let's see the next slide, please. Now, this is the current distribution of variants of concern in the world. Alpha is at 185 countries, beta is in 136 countries, and gamma is in 81 countries. But importantly, Delta has gone now to 142 countries. And second observation, which we have to observe, is India has all four variants of concern: Alpha, Beta, Gamma, and Delta. And Delta is spreading all across the world now. If you remember last month, it was 125 countries. Now it is 142 countries. So it is spreading like wildfire across the world. Next slide, please. Now we shall discuss the current situation in our country in terms of districts, in terms of the trends, in terms of vaccination. Over the past month, the 30 most populous districts, accounting for roughly a sixth of India's population, have reduced the number of active COVID cases to 45,349 on 11th August from 81,500 on 12th of July. So over a month, there's been substantial decrease. Deaths and weekly new cases have also dropped, enabling relaxation of lockdown measures. However, there are differences in vaccination coverage, raising concerns about resurgence in COVID cases in some of these districts. A month ago, Pune, Thane, Bangalore Urban, and Mumbai each had over 10,000 active cases. Now, except for Pune, none of the top 30 districts have over 10,000 active cases. Thane saw the biggest reduction in the number of cases, both in absolute number of cases, down by 10,358, and adjusted for population, 1,041 per million people. Similarly, the number of weekly new cases in the top 30 districts came down by over 8,000 to 22,000 cases at present, led by Thane, Pune, and East Godavari. The number of weekly deaths have dropped to 364 from 999 a month ago, with Pune, the district with the highest toll in this group, seeing its death down to 108 in the past week. However, while vaccination coverage has improved across these districts, the pace of improvement has been very, very uneven. 5 districts have received less than 200 per 1,000 population. 12 of these 30 districts increased vaccination coverage by 100 doses per 1,000 population for the past month, led by Patna, Bangalore Urban, and Ahmedabad. The bottom two, that is both in West Bengal, increased it by less than 60 per 1,000. So we find vaccination is very uneven in India's most populous districts. Let's go and see the situation in the form of a graph. This is vaccination coverage below par in North and the East. Bangalore Urban leads vaccination coverage among India's most populous districts, as you can see on the figure on the right side. Bangalore Urban, if you see the gap between 12 July and 11th August, it is vaccinating very fast. Other are Ahmedabad, Mumbai, Pune, Nagpur, Surat, and Patna. These are the top 7. But also look at the bottom 7. East Champaran in Bihar, Gaya in Bihar, Prayagraj in Uttar Pradesh, Muzaffarpur in Bihar, Murshidabad in West Bengal, Samastipur in Bihar, and Sitapur in Uttar Pradesh are at the bottom. And if you look at out of 7, 4 are in Bihar. So there is an area of concern in Uttar Pradesh, West Bengal, and Bihar. So they need to ensure that there is increased even distribution of vaccination in the districts, in especially the districts mentioned over here. Let's see the next slide where we review the vaccination vis-a-vis other countries. Asian players ramping up vaccination faster than India. Weekly change in COVID-19 vaccine doses per 100 people is in red figure, the bar diagram, and cumulative COVID-19 vaccination per 100 people, each country is shown in gray, the graph on the extreme right. Globally, Bangladesh retained its top spot among the 10 most populous countries in the weekly increase in vaccination coverage, with a growth of 36.8% this week, even though its vaccination coverage still remains low at 11.7% partially vaccinated people per 100 population. But Bangladesh is not the only Asian country in this list to have ramped up its vaccination pace. Indonesia, the Philippines, and Japan all recorded a faster pace of vaccination compared to India over the past week. Japan's acceleration follows a surge in cases after the Summer Olympics. It reported a 7-day moving average of 13,967 daily cases in the past week, over three times the 3,787 cases at the beginning of the event. Japan has so far partially vaccinated 83.6 people out of 100, lagging only China and the United States. Meanwhile, in the United States, several companies have mandated vaccines for employees as cases in the country increased by 84% in the past 14 days. Across countries, vaccination coverage increased to 16.38% this week, up from 6.7% last week. Let's go and see the next slide, where we review the hotspots of our country. This is the district-wise graph of India, where five districts reported 10,000 plus cases over the past week. Which are those districts? Palghat, 13,447, Thrissur, 17,177, Ernakulam, 15,744, Malappuram, 22,290, and Kozhikode, 15,879, all are in Kerala. New reported cases in India decreased by 6% in the past week, following an increase of 5.33% in the previous week. Yet, there are pockets of concern. According to government data, 37 districts in India are still reporting an increasing trend in daily new cases in the last 2 weeks. Kerala has 11 of these districts, followed by Tamil Nadu, 7, Himachal Pradesh, 6, and Karnataka, 5. Amravati in Maharashtra has reported the sharpest week-on-week increase in cases. It has had 1,129 cases in the past 7 days, which is up from 243 in the last week and 72 2 weeks ago. It is followed by Bilaspur, Chamba, and Hamirpur, which are all from Himachal Pradesh. In each of these districts, cases went up by at least 142% in the past week. The Himachal Pradesh government has reimposed lockdown restrictions merely 9 days after lifting them. So, eternal vigilance once again. Let's see the next slide and review the situation. This is a situation of deaths. Kerala is the only major state to report a significant rise in deaths. This is a graph showing rolling 7-day average deaths in our country. Deaths in India due to COVID-19 were down by 5.6% in the past week, a steeper decline than previous week, which is 1.3%. 10 states and union territories have reported an increase in deaths this week, but all except Kerala from a lower base. Kerala has once again reported an increase of 20.55% in deaths this week after reporting a decline of 10.24% last week. Overall, none of the states have reported 1,000 plus deaths this week. Maharashtra saw a sharp decline as deaths reported in the state dropped by 24.58% in the past week from 1,265 to 954. There are two districts, both from Odisha, which are still witnessing an increase in mortality on a higher base. Even though deaths in Odisha decreased very marginally in the last week, Khurda and Katak saw a jump of 81.48% and 73.33% in deaths to 147 and 78 respectively. Now we see another aspect of epidemiology of COVID-19. Next slide, please. This is the COVID deaths are many times official estimates. This data is now being presented from YouGov, Mint, CPR, Millennial Survey. and it consists of a survey which suggests that this is the most likely a colossal underestimation. 17% surveyed respondents said they lost someone in their household due to COVID-19 this year. This translates to 13.9 million deaths among India's urban netizens. The YouGov Mint CPR Millennial Survey was conducted online during June, July, and covered 10,285 respondents from unique households spread across 203 cities and towns. The total number of active internet users in urban India was 323 million in 2020, according to the industry body Internet and Mobile Association of India, that is AMI. Assuming an average household size of 3.9, the average urban family size estimated by the National Sample Survey study in 2018, we arrive at a figure of 13.9 million deaths. This estimate also relies on the assumption that at most one death occurred in a household, making it a slightly conservative estimate. The scale of COVID-19 tragedy is evident from the fact that 6 in 10 respondents reported losing someone in their own family or close circle. Among the largest Indian cities, Delhi and Hyderabad saw relatively higher death tolls. So far, most reports have relied on the civil registration system, that is CRS, or the National Health Mission, NHM data, to estimate the COVID toll. A recent research paper by the economist Arvind Subramaniam and his co-authors suggested an excess mortality toll ranging from 3.4 million to 4.9 million. Our estimate, based on the latest survey, is the first of its kind, figured from a large-scale nationwide survey, albeit one that is restricted to urban netizens. But let's see the data. In the absence of any other data, large majority of people have lost someone in their families or close contact. 63% say lost someone among family, relative, friends, or colleagues. 36% saying lost someone from extended family. 17% said lost someone from family, same household. 16% said lost a close friend. 12% said lost a colleague. And 26% said none of the above. And 11% preferred not to answer. If we look at the residents in Hyderabad and Delhi, if we look at the graph on the right, the most deaths were in Hyderabad and Delhi. Respondents who lost someone in their families, same household due to COVID-19 since beginning of 2021. Hyderabad 19%, Delhi 19%, Mumbai 17%, Bangalore 17%, Kolkata 16%, and Chennai 12%. Let's see at the next graph. This is getting hospital beds or oxygen cylinders was difficult in most neighborhoods. 55% hospital beds, 50% oxygen cylinders, 46% medical attention or treatment after admission, and 41% required medicines. This is the percentage of respondents who themselves or whose family or neighbors faced difficulty in getting. The government officials have sought to underplay the extent of underreporting in official data, even as they brush aside complaints about shortage of hospital beds and oxygen during the pandemic's peak this year. Replying to a question in the Rajya Sabha on 20th July, the Union Health Minister said no such reports of patients dying due to a shortage of oxygen and lack of hospital facilities were received from any state. But the respondents of the YouGov Mint CPR Millennial Survey reported, and in large numbers, that they knew of patients who faced difficulties in getting bed or oxygen cylinders in the past few months. As many as 46% knew of cases when a patient died due to lack of medical supplies, including oxygen. And 63% reported that they themselves or someone in their family or in the immediate neighborhood had difficulty finding a hospital bed or an oxygen cylinder or both. Over 40% also experienced trouble in getting required medicines and treatment. Let's look at another data set. Next slide, please. This is loss of lives because of inadequate medical support was common across states. 56% Uttar Pradesh, Delhi 54%, Andhra Pradesh 58%. As health is a state subject, death numbers are collected from hospitals by state governments. After the Union Health Minister's claim that no deaths took place due to oxygen shortage, state after state, from Maharashtra to Bihar, joined the chorus, saying they had adequate or surplus supply of oxygen, and no deaths took place because of oxygen shortages. But the survey indicates otherwise, with a large proportion of respondents across states reporting patients who lost their life due to lack of medical oxygen. In Maharashtra, for instance, 44% respondents know of a patient dying due to a lack of oxygen, failure in getting hospital admission, or the lack of medicines. The share of such respondents was the highest in Andhra Pradesh, 58%, Uttar Pradesh, 56%, while Kerala, 22%, fared relatively better on this score. The state-wise figures should, however, be seen only as rough estimates, given the wide variation in the share of urban populations and the share of survey respondents across states. Let's see another data set. This data set shows you collateral damage, that is, non-COVID patients also bearing the burden of the brunt of the second wave. This graph shows you the percent of respondents to responses to how easy or difficult do you think the following are for people in your locality. Very easy is blue, somewhat easy is gray, neither easy nor difficult is pink, somewhat difficult is dark pink, and very difficult is maroon. During the peak of second wave, non-COVID patients found it difficult to access medical care. About 4 in 10 respondents said non-COVID patients in the neighborhood had a difficult time getting admitted, comparable to the share of respondents who reported of difficulties for COVID patients. The survey was conducted jointly by the Indian arm of the global market research firm YouGov, Mint, and the Delhi-based think tank Center for Policy Research. Around half the respondents were millennials, while the rest were pre-millennials, that is 40 plus, or post-millennials, that is aged 18 to 24. The survey is the sixth in a series of biannual surveys aimed at examining the aspirations, anxieties, and attitudes of India's digital natives. The findings illustrate the extraordinary toll of the pandemic. They also serve as an important reminder on the need to do all it takes to avoid a deadly third wave. That was the purpose of sharing this data set with you. Eternal vigilance. If freedom is to be maintained, eternal vigilance. If freedom from pandemic is to be maintained, eternal vigilance. So again, reminding you about eternal vigilance to retain our freedom for the country and from the pandemic. So now, in the end, I will share a video on the occasion of the Independence Day, that is tomorrow. Let's share the video and the sentiments.
सारे विश्व में संकट मंडरा रहा है, ऐसे वक्त में
आज पूरा भारत ये कहना चाह रहा है,
न हारे थे न हारे हैं, एक दूजे के सहारे हैं, हम हिंदुस्तानी आसमां के वो सितारे हैं,
जो फिर से जगमगाएंगे, फिर से मुस्कराएंगे, इस लम्हे को हराएंगे, देख लेना,
पल दो पल की ये तो है परेशानी, ना तू दास बन दिया,
ये लम्हे बीत जाएंगे, हम फिर से मुस्कुराएंगे, इस लम्हे को हराएंगे, देख लेना,
ये लम्हे बीत जाएंगे, हम फिर से मुस्कुराएंगे, इस लम्हे को हराएंगे, देख लेना,
देख लेना,
ये लम्हे बीत जाएंगे, हम फिर से मुस्कुराएंगे,
इस लम्हे को हराएंगे।
लम्हे बीत जाएंगे, हम फिर से मुस्कुराएंगे, इस लम्हे को हराएंगे, देख लेना। भी मिट जाएंगे बिखरे दिल सिमट जाएंगे, पहले जैसे हम आएंगे,
हौसले भी गूंज उठेंगे, बंदरवाजे खुल जाएंगे, पहले जैसे हम आएंगे,
फिर फूल साकल उठेगा हिंदुस्तान, देख लेना।
नहारे थे नहारे हैं,
एक दूजे के सहारे हैं,
हम हिंदुस्तानी
आसमां के वो सितारे हैं,
जो फिर से जगमगाएंगे,
फिर से मुस्कुराएंगे,
इस लम्हे को हराएंगे,
देख लेना।
Thank you and Jai Hind.
Thank you, Dr. Rajiv. I think it was a great and enriching update. Without any ado, I see that we have some hands up. This time we are going to have questions towards the end. Can I just check if there are questions? Can we hold them for the session after Dr. Sandeep? All right. Thank you so much. Can I now invite our next distinguished speaker, Dr. Sandeep Sharma? Dr. Sandeep Sharma does not require any introduction. He has been one of our own faculties who has been ensuring the entire dissemination, not only in his organization, but much more beyond. Dr. Sandeep has been responsible for implementation of the occupational health systems and procedures in Indian Oil. He has also been responsible for upgradation of occupational health systems all across. He has published corporate manuals on occupational health, fatigue management, lifestyle, as well as has put up some excellent workshops on happiness. I think all of us are very familiar. He has been the convener of this forum for long. He has been the secretary for the AEOHD branch, as well as the National General Secretary. More importantly, he has represented his organization at different forums, both national and international. So can I now invite Dr. Sandeep to take the next session?
Thank you, Dr. Ashish, President sir, and all the participants for sparing their valuable time for this session on the eve of Independence Day. And I'm not an expert, but whatever I'll be talking is what we have gained from our speakers in last 64 sessions, which we had held during this DigiConnect webinar. And I would actually like to summarize what we have learned from these speakers. And as Dr. Rajiv Jain sir told, that yes, the situation is not under control, and still we have to do lot of things to like stay with this pandemic. It's almost 1.5 years in this turbulent times, and I hope my screen is visible to everyone now.
Yes, sir.
That's visible.
Yes, it's visible.
So I would be summarizing certain things which we should keep in our mind so that we can stay with this virus for a long time, because I don't think it is possible for us to eradicate this virus in near future. And almost we have lost 1.5 year of our precious lives. The students, they have lost their classes, and many people, they have lost their jobs. They have just been suffering from the miseries of this COVID pandemic. Yes, coronavirus is invisible, and but its effects are quite visible everywhere, and we are now seeing its effects after the second wave in India to a great extent, as this virus is now changing the lives of our people radically without ever revealing itself directly. All this is because this invisible virus has entered our lives, and it has spread globally across the globe. It is invisible because we cannot see it through our naked eyes, and it is invincible because it is too powerful to be defeated or to overcome. It is running two steps ahead of our preparations, and whenever we think that we have conquered the pandemic, it again shows some variants of concern, and they actually show us that we are still too weak in front of this invisible virus. So as Dr. Rajeev Jain sir has already told, that COVID-19 has spread across the globe. Now it has infected more than 20 crore people across the globe, and more than 43 lakh people, they have lost their life because of this pandemic. And after this second wave, this is what we have seen in the last few months. Lot of mystery, lot of like Dr. Rajeev sir has told, the death survey. So almost every family, they have suffered from some sort of loss in their families. They have suffered the miseries of this pandemic. They have suffered the shortage of medicine, shortage of hospital beds, shortage of oxygen, whatever may be the government data, but we have suffered. We all know that, yes, we have suffered, and still, if we are not careful, we will be suffering a lot if this pandemic is not under control. So the COVID-19 has affected the lives and the livelihood of the people across the world, with declining business and the economy. And there has been a crushing impact on the international tourism also, with a sharp decline in the tourism industry. Now flights are closed for general public, general tourism, and everyone is now stuck in their bubbles so that they can remain safe and they don't transmit the infection. Even the there is visible threat of the virus, like the loss of the jobs, loss, slowing of the economy, effects on the social and mental, physical development of the people, and physical and mental development of the children. This is all affecting us, and more than half a billion people, they have been now below the poverty line, and they have been pushed because of the pandemic. Now, we have to decide that, can we live with the COVID-19 pandemic in the current situation? The COVID-19 has unleashed hopes for the change in our society, and has also made us more aware of the shared humanity, the value of strong local communities, and the importance of our connections with the nature. It has reawakened people to the way the human activity affects the environment. It tells us that we should not play with the nature also, because it is all because of this viral labs, this experiments which were going on there. Most probably it has come out from there only. So at present, what is hopeful is the vaccines and the preparedness. So at present, these two are the only things which we cannot afford to ignore to come out of this crisis. And the challenge, therefore, is to get ourselves updated with the latest information about the virus, get ourselves vaccinated, and keep our preparations two steps ahead of the virus, because this virus is running two steps ahead of us, and it camouflages all the preparations which we do to mitigate this COVID pandemic. So COVID-19 pandemic may never go away, but it is possible that we can live with it normally. And in this context, it is better to learn living with the virus. Now, why our goals need to be to live with the virus? This I have mentioned in earlier forums also, that till date, only one virus like smallpox, it has been eradicated. And there were also certain reasons why it was eradicated, because we had a stable vaccine for this. And the symptoms were quite obvious. We can physically see the signs and we can decide, yes, it is smallpox. And it took decades to get control over the smallpox. And even in case of measles also, this vaccine and the symptoms, they are quite stable, and it is a stable virus. But COVID-19 is quite unstable virus, and with rapid transmission, now it is developing a lot of variants of interest and various variants of concern, as Dr. Rajiv sir has told, that alpha, beta, gamma, delta, so many variants are there, and even the delta wave, the delta, it has spread across so many continents now. Now, what we should aim, we can aim for a zero COVID strategy, but basically it means to bring COVID-19 cases close to zero in a territory. Like in India, now it is spread in Kerala, in northeastern states, in certain states in the southern region. Now, although the transmission now is increasing in Himachal Pradesh also, so we should try to restrict them in particular geographical territories with the help of effective testing, tracing, and treatment strategy and the vaccine strategy, so that the pandemic, it becomes endemic and it may remain there, and gradually it will die its own death. But for this, we need cooperation from our general public, that we should get ourselves vaccinated and get all the COVID appropriate norms in place, so that the transmission, it reduces, and the variants, they are less in the circulation. Now, how can we continue living with the virus? There are many choices which lie ahead, and we can grapple with the fallout of the pandemic. The decision being made now in our families, communities, nation, it will have a lot of consequences for generations. Even the businesses, now they have decided, and they are deciding that they have to live with the virus. So for continuity of our businesses also, people are now, they have tightened their belt that we have to live with the virus. So we will follow all the norms, and we will get our workforce vaccinated. In this regard, we have seen that many corporates, even like Reliance, they have Hindustan Unilever, they have already covered more than 99%. Indian Oil, they have covered 85%. Many other corporates, they have covered more than 80-90%. But covering them with vaccination is not enough until and unless the whole of our community is vaccinated. Because as Dr. Rajiv sir has also told, that vaccines, they can minimize the severeness of the infection, but the transmission can still be there, and people can remain an asymptomatic carrier. But still, we need to get vaccinated, and we need to follow all the COVID appropriate norms. So for living with the virus, we should ensure vaccination. And this definitely helps. Now people are more focused on the effectiveness of the vaccine rather than the efficacy of the vaccine, because efficacy, now it has shown that efficacy, it varies with the variants, with the mutations. And we have seen this in case of many good claimed to be good vaccines, like mRNA vaccines, or even our Covishield or even the Chinese vaccine and many other vaccines, they have shown that their efficacy, it goes down with the new mutant, but effectiveness is definitely remain there. And it is proved now that effectiveness of the vaccine, that has to be our concern rather than efficacy of the vaccine. So everyone should go for vaccination, and we should try to avoid vaccine hesitancy among the people. Then what is required is strict policies for COVID appropriate norms. This we have to follow in our organizations also, and we have to request the local communities, state, and the state government, district governments, that we have to follow the COVID appropriate norms, and strict policies should be there. And even I've heard in the newspaper that many crores were collected as a fine from not people not wearing mask in Delhi. So it means people are not following the rules, and they are complacent about the situation. And this complacency can lead to disasters, and it can lead to future surge in the COVID cases. So, which will be a great problem for every one of us. So we have to follow the COVID appropriate norms. We have to assume that everything is infected. So whenever we go out, whenever something comes in your house, or even if your mates come, or someone for domestic help, or some other help, civil work or some plumbing work, if they come to your household, then take all due precautions, and you assume that everything is infected. When you go out also, whenever you try avoid touching the frequently touched surfaces, and try to take all the precautions, because everything outside may be infected. So if we take all these precautions, then definitely we will be saved from the virus infection. Then we have to redefine our social norms. Like I have seen in families also that now, because they have been locked up for a long time in their houses, now people are starting going out and mixing with their near and dear ones. Now the festival season is also coming. So people behavior, that is also very important. Even those who have lost their near and dear ones, I have seen the families in which no one has visited as a courtesy also to their home, and this was the right approach. People were having the ceremonies on the Zoom or some virtual platform, but these social things, they need to be very we have to be very careful. Even this Kamad Yatra during this last festive season before Shivratri, it was taken care of. It was stopped on the behest of the Supreme Court, and the state government didn't allow that. So these are the things which we should avoid, because otherwise what will happen, people will come in close contact and they can transmit to each other, and that will be a big problem. So we have to practice, and we have to preach also the same thing, that we have to improve upon our social behaviors. Maybe we still wait for a few months before we socialize, because yes, human being is a social animal, but society, if it increase the transmission by intermixing, then it is quite dangerous. Then we have to strengthen our community engagement. This is very important, because this we have seen in the second wave. Even the residential colonies, now they are having their COVID care centers. They have got some sort of arrangement for giving the first aid to the people who may be affected during this COVID times. And this is very important. Local community support is very important, because we have seen the hospitals, we have seen all the corporate hospitals. Because we are all from corporate organizations, and we were so much dependent upon these corporate hospitals that they will provide us bed. And we are all working in organizations because our medical facilities are quite lucrative. But we have seen that in the time of need, no one was available with us, no bed was available, no oxygen was available. So what is required is we need to build up our community structure. Wherever we are, if we are staying in townships, if we are staying in local societies, we have to at least arrange for some beds, some resources, some ambulance services we need to engage, so that we don't have to depend upon the hospitals for any surge in the COVID cases. Then we have to definitely bring a behavioral change in our life, and COVID crisis, it requires a large scale behavioral change, and social and behavioral sciences can be helpful to align human behavior with the changing scenario. So we can start some employee assistance program in our organization where these programs are not there. And now the organization, they have already started, but this is an advice that they should take care of the mental health of the people, because they have already suffered a huge loss, physical and economical and the social and mental also. Then what is important is we have to avoid panic buying, because this we have seen in families, in our own house also, that we are all panic buyers. So we don't have to do the panic buying, because otherwise it will cause acute shortage, and it will cause rise in the prices in the market, and the people who need them actually they will be suffering. We have seen that people had been hoarding these medicines during this COVID pandemic, and even the very cheap medicine like prednisolone, that was not available. Even this paracetamol was not available at many places. People have to rush for oxygen cylinders. They have to stand in queues for oxygen cylinders. And oxygen concentrators were not available, because they were all stuck up with some VIPs or some people who can afford them earlier, and they were hoarding all these resources. So inequality in the access of the resources, that will be a great problem. So we should avoid all these things, but we should keep something in reserve, but don't make your house as a hoarding house for all these essential commodities. Then we have to take care of the children, because children's schools are closed for last 1.5 years, and we need to open the schools with precautions. And because children are still, they are not vaccinated, and as we have heard from our previous speakers also in last webinars, that schools are very important for social, mental and physical development of the children. And studies, they have shown that 1 year closure of a school can lead to 2 year loss for the children. This was told by Dr. Laharia, so a great public health expert. So this children now they need to be taken care of, and gradually schools should be opened up. At least the primary schools, they should be opened up, and gradually we can with all norms, with all teachers vaccinated, with all proper COVID appropriate facilities, we need to gradually open up the schools. And we have to go for a graded opening. This was also told by our previous speakers, that unlock is simply not removing the restrictions, but it is a gradient dynamic strategy which needs to be followed. Our previous speakers, they told that we need to open the outdoors first. We have to open the parks, the public spaces, and we should also start moving in these open spaces, because here there is a lot of fresh air is there, circulation of air is there, and there is no concentration of the virus. So a lot of dilution of the virus will be there. So even if someone catches infection, it is in very mild doses. So after opening, mild exposure will be there. So after opening for 2 to 3 weeks of the outdoor openings, indoor they need to be gradually opened. And micro-social behavior assessment need to be followed by micro-containment of the affected areas. So this we are following in our organizations also. Now gradually people are moving towards opening up. So open spaces, they need to be gradually opened up first, then depending upon the people's behavior, the other spaces, they need to be gradually opened up. Then maids and domestic helps and the people who are coming to our houses, they may be a source of infection. So we have to take all due precautions for them. And we have to enlist and ensure the precautions to be taken by them. And they have to wear masks, they have to be vaccinated, they have to work in an open space. The house should be well ventilated before and after their work. So all these precautions, they need to be taken. And even our family members, they have to be very careful about all these precautions, because we have seen in many cases, people are not going out of the house. They are not taking all precautions. Especially, I can quote Milkha Singh. He said, me and my wife, they never went out of the house for last 1 year, but it was their cook who was having fever, and they sent him to his hometown. But ultimately, both of them, they caught infection. Both of them were severe, and ultimately they succumbed to the COVID. So this has happened in many families, that the domestic servants, they have brought the infection. So we have to be very careful about this. So in that also, we have to change our behavior towards our work in the home. We should try to distribute work among our family members, so that we are not exposed to the outsiders who are almost on daily basis, they are coming to our houses. Then we need to stay connected, because as human beings, we are all social animals, and we need to be fit and to our society. And there are now a lot of virtual platform, telephones and other things are there. So we need to connect with our family, so that at least our emotions, our mental health, everything, it remains in balance. And we love to socialize and communicate with the people. So instead of physical communication, physical connection, we should better utilize all these platforms, and that will help people to take care of the transmission of the virus. Then another important thing is we need to be stay informed properly about the latest developments which are there about the virus, about the variants which are there in the circulation, about the new government guidelines, because another invisible enemy is the misinformation and fake news about the virus. Authentic, concise and effective communication of information, that is very, very essential. So we need to stay updated. For this, we don't have to sit in front of the television round the clock, or just reading the newspaper all the time, or on the social media. We just have to like authentic sources, whichever are there, Ministry of Health, WHO, other reliable sources, which you think that yes, these are the reliable sources which have given you the trusted authentic news for last 1.5 years. You believe on that, and be sure to use your own good critical thinking skills before making an opinion about the news items, because a lot of rumors will be there in the market. So take care of yourself and stay informed. Then be extra careful and alert, because this is an invisible virus, and it is said that you cannot hit what you cannot see. But human beings has evolved to respond to the real that exists. And considering our limited ability to fight this invisible, we need to be extra careful, because we do not know who is a asymptomatic carrier, which surface is infected. So we have to think everything as infected and take all necessary due precautions. Then another thing, with opening up, with relaxations, now people are like wanting to go to places which they have not visited for last 1.5 year. But still, it is advisable that you limit your travels unless it is necessary. Travel, like any other activities, they involve meeting with the people, and this will lead to further transmission of the virus even after you are fully vaccinated. And this we have seen in like Kerala, lot of relaxations were there. And now we are seeing that more than 50% of the cases, they are coming from Kerala. We have seen the hill stations, they were overcrowded by the travelers during this last 1 month, and that is a great risk to everyone, because after getting infected, if they are getting infected, when they go back to their own native places, they will carry the infection and they can transmit the infections in the virgin spaces which were not affected earlier. So setting a routine is also very important for every one of us, because for last 1.5 years our all schedules have been disturbed. So instead of waiting for the pandemic to be over, we should try to make a routine of our lives. In addition to doing your work, make sure to schedule your time for physical, emotional, sleep, fun, creativity, social connections, and stress relief. So take it as normal. Don't get panic, because now scientific evidences, they are all there. They have shown that we can get rid of this virus by all the COVID appropriate norms, following all the COVID appropriate norms, and by the vaccination. So another important thing is we have to monitor our health. We should not ignore our comorbidities. We have to not ignore the things, our symptoms, because if we are ignoring our health, then definitely because of this 1.5 year of lockdown or 1.5 year of our reduced activities, our immunity has also gone low. So we are prone to catch infections, and we are prone to many more diseases, maybe the non-communicable diseases. We have to monitor our sugar levels, we have to monitor our blood pressure and other things, so that we remain fit and fine. Then these comorbidities like diabetes, hypertension, they must be effectively managed. Immunity boosters and other things, they should be taken. And we should not be take these medicine in overdoses, because otherwise what we have seen, people have been taking vitamin C, zinc and other vitamins for a very long time, and even this mucormycosis, they have correlated that it may be due to the increase in the zinc levels of your body. Maybe it may be true or it may not be true, but still we have to be very careful that vitamin toxicity, that can also lead to problems. So in addition to the necessary medicines for your comorbidities, you should better take the fresh fruits and vegetables with antioxidants and other things, rather than depending only upon the vitamins for this. Then we have to take care of our mental health. One of the central emotional responses during the pandemic is fear, and an emotional response to a risky situation can influence the thinking, and that is a reason why employee assistance program in companies is very important. And the experience of fear and threat has ramifications not only on how people think about themselves, but also how they feel about and react to the others. So mental health, along with the basic required protocol, need to be taken care of, especially in organizations and in private also, by each one of us. Regular physical activity is very important, and if we are unable to find open space outside our house, then we should do some indoor physical activity, so that at least our muscles, they are toned up, and we don't become susceptible for infections. Then we have to ensure proper and adequate ventilation. Yes, the temperature and the atmosphere is right now, it's quite humid and hot, but still we have to, whenever we get time, we should ensure appropriate and suitable ventilation, because ventilation must also be improved at home and in offices also. Organization, they are taking care of the ventilation by different mechanism, maybe using HEPA filters or other things, but at home we can at least open our doors and windows for some time and get some fresh air, and this will definitely help in diluting the concentration of the virus in the surrounding atmosphere. Then we have to organizations, they have to invest in the health system, and definitely this will help in making our infrastructure robust in case and take care of any surge in the cases. But that all depends upon how robust is our healthcare infrastructure. And yes, government is working, other people are also working, organizations are also now working towards this, and they are having their own resources to strengthen their healthcare infrastructure rather than depending upon these corporate hospitals and other private sector hospitals. Then another thing what we should propagate in our respective organizations also, because we have got a lot of CSR funds in our organizations, and they have to invest in research, because research needs funding now in India. And we are now moving towards Atmanirbhar Bharat, and we have seen the progress which we have made in last 1.5 year, when we were not having PPE ventilators earlier during the start of the pandemic. Now we are quite self-sufficient, and we are quite self-sufficient even in the field of vaccines also. So we need to support and invest in the research and development on the therapeutic agents and vaccines for COVID-19 related human coronavirus diseases. So we are all in the same team in bringing an end to the COVID-19. But still, we need to be very careful. And finally, whether we can live with this invisible enemy, SARS-CoV-2 virus, depends on our acceptance that COVID-19 will remain there and in small geographical pockets, and other collective behavior towards the virus, they need to change. We have to change our behavior towards this virus, follow all the COVID appropriate norms, and get ourselves vaccinated, and get our people also vaccinated who are working with us or who are in day-to-day contact with us. We should tell them that they should not be hesitant about the vaccine, and they should get themselves vaccinated. And lastly, if all of us shoulder this burden together and follow these norms, our society will be safe. And this is the only way we can keep ourselves safe from the invisible danger of this invisible and invincible virus, and start a normal living with new norms of life. Because this virus will stay for a long time with us, and we don't see any relaxation from the virus invasion. Maybe it is not there in some locality, but we do not know from when it will get, when the people get infected from the variants of concerns or variants, different variants, which can be transmitted in their virgin areas. And ultimately, we have to keep our children safe, as they are our future, and still they are not vaccinated. And we have to take care of their physical and mental health, because ultimately, they are the people who are affected most. And they will take our journey forward, and they will be there for another 50, 60, 70 years, and they have to live with this new norms. And with this, I thank you all very much. Be safe, be healthy, and remain safe with all the COVID appropriate norms. Get vaccinated so that we are all safe and we can take care of each other. So thank you very much. With this, I finish my deliberations. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sandeep. Thanks for this excellent session. So I think let me open this session for question and answers. I noticed that we have Dr. Gajend, whose hand is up. Dr. Gajend, your question, please.
First of all, I compliment both the speakers for wonderful presentation. Dr. Rajiv Kumar Jain has given very, very detailed information about the subject. And Dr. Sandeep has given us very simple tips to take care of ourselves and our family in this time of pandemic. And now for Dr. Rajiv, I have two observations rather. Number one, the vaccination in the whole of Bihar and Eastern UP, the pace of vaccination has decreased. And one of the most probable causes is that these two areas are facing flood for last now almost a month, more than a month. During the flood, vaccination program cannot be run concurrently. So that there is a very valid reason for decrease in the pace of vaccination in these areas. This is my one observation. My second observation is, as in the previous talks, I was raising the issue of the number of deaths and number of cases. The proper counter, as I was always telling, is most important. Probably these surveys which he has mentioned, they have brought out the same point. And if the findings of the surveys are near to correct or correct, then that means we have already faced a very, 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 very big problem. Large number of deaths were there, though those were hidden, those were not put to the surface, those were not counted, and so is the number of cases. So this comes to a point, we come to a point where the epidemiological work need to be strengthened and it has to be honest. And another point I would like to raise, that let us fight COVID on scientific grounds, not on political grounds. That is very, very important. And now coming to Dr. Sandeep's point, Dr. Sandeep, the difficult area making ventilation of homes is very simple. But the difficulty is making ventilation in the enclosed office spaces. Like in my hospital, I work in Central Hospital, Railway Hospital in Connaught Place, which is 416-bedded hospital. And the whole building is now sealed because it is centrally air-conditioned. Now, keeping ventilation in such huge buildings, and that too in a hospital environment where all type of patients are moving in and out, that seems to be the most difficult. The solution are, of course, there technical solutions are there, but how honestly these solutions are being followed by the department or by the concerned engineering department is a big question. So this is my, you can say, remark on your presentation. With these few words, I conclude, and I again congratulate both my speakers of the day. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Gajendra. I also have the other hand raised, and we have Dr. Tyagaraju. Dr. Tyagaraju, can you please share your questions or observations?
And first questions to Dr. Rajiv Kumar Jain. Sir, this, especially this COVID SARS-2, has got a lot of affection towards European countries, Brazil, America, and India. But whereas it has a very little effect on African countries. Earlier, we used to see SARS, other viruses, have a lot of effect on these African countries. And what is the difference? Why the SARS-CoV-2 19 has got more affinity towards India and European countries? Can anything would you like to tell us, sir?
Well, if you look at the history of SARS-CoV-2, you would easily recollect it all started from interaction between China and Italy. The trade between China and Italy, and then the international aviation movement and the people's movement coterminous. Now, if you look at the map of airlines, the density of travel by airlines in the world, the lowest number of flights are in Africa. I don't know whether you've traveled to Africa. It's very, very difficult. You have to go to Europe first to be able to go from India to Africa. There are very few flights, right? And it is in Europe, you have to change the aircraft or the airport, and then you reach Africa. So I can understand the difficulty the virus is facing in reaching and multiplying within Africa. Now, if you look at the map of mobility in Africa, it's very, very low. It's in a different era. The Africans, the inter-country travel is very much restricted. And compounded to this is a very poor infrastructure for testing. In normal times also, a very poor health infrastructure, which is compounded by the situation that very little testing. Even if the cases are there, the testing infrastructure is being poor, they're not tested. And in addition, the highest deaths due to malaria happen in Africa, even today. So fever is rampant and fever is considered normal. You know, it's like an endemic situation, but they don't get worried. And modern healthcare system is not that effective in Africa. So these could be the possible reasons, but if in epidemiology, we don't go on numbers, we go on trends. Now, if we look at the trend in the recent past, the increase is very fast, both cases and deaths. So that is an ominous sign. The disease is following its trajectory and pandemic is, as you have seen, it is rolling down from one country to another, one region to another. Like if it was in India, Indonesia was silent, Myanmar was silent, Thailand was silent. But now what do you see? Bangladesh, Myanmar, Thailand, Indonesia. You see rapid increase in cases and then rapid increase in deaths. A similar trajectory will follow in Africa. If you see that the, South Africa has already gone through one phase, other countries have started the phase of upsurge, and it is directly related to mobility for travel, trade, housing, employment, number of diseases. So epidemiologically, the trend towards pandemic moving from one continent to another shall be maintained, and within the continent, the travel will determine the trajectory in each country. And then within the country, intra-district travel also will determine. So that like in India, you've seen from urban areas, from metro to urban to rural, you've seen it all. And we are going through one trajectory to another trajectory. And then now you're seeing in US, if it was one wave, now it is the Delta wave. So country after country will face the Delta wave. So that is what the epidemiology of COVID-19 tells. So it's going to be a long haul, and we should prepare for long haul. Vaccine may become ineffective, then we have new vaccines, the booster doses or the modified vaccines, that cycle will also continue. That is the current evidence that is showing.
Thank you very much, sir. I have a question to Dr. Sandeep Sharma ji. Dr. Sandeep Sharma ji, you have proved that 2020 and 21, that AEOHD is the temple of occupational health. The webinars are significant impact on our education knowledge. You have also proved that it is a temple of occupational health. And your speech was really innovative. You have remarkably very high standard speech, because we have noted that it is neither copied in the book nor anything can be. You have very, very neatly, you have collected the data and you have put it as a marker, and it is a really a benchmark, and you have proved that it is a very, very knowledgeable, and it is really a great that every occupational health physician should see the headings and do this one, and it will definitely help them. And only one small request. Now HICO is coming. In that it is a virtual conference. In a virtual conference, usually people will see how these other countries will fare in especially in webinars or how they present the papers. I think one thing is these webinars cannot be, these lectures cannot be put it in YouTube, because whatever we do, it should be in our domain only. So people who are presenting the papers can be go through people like you, our Shyam Pingle, Dr. Rajgopal, Dr. Shanbag, who are all presented papers very well. And I also in Singapore, when I presented my paper on arthroscopic view of the knee joint and also the low back head, Dr. J. Jayaratnam was very happy, and he was talking to me for a long time. Suppose if I had not presented the paper, you would not have talked to me so much so. So what I think that presenting the papers is a really a great one. And you can guide them, you can tell them where is their mistake and all. And we have a very good chance during this webinar, we can bring Haiko, which is a since a long time, it is a India is very much concerned and approaching to get this Haiko. I think with you, Dr. Shyam Pingle is regularly attending, and he can also help. And Dr. Shyam Rajgopal and Dr. Rajiv Jain and Dr. Shanbag also can help to shape this investor. These people who are going to present these papers can be guided properly and nicely, and tell them, and they can be presented. Only thing is, you should not be presented in YouTube, because that is the condition in HICO, that it should not be presented anywhere. That is the this one. Thank you very much. You have done a very good, and it is definitely AUHD proved that 2020 and 21 is the temple of occupational health, these webinars. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you,
thank
sir.
You. Thank you, Dr. Mariba. I note that there's a question from Dr. Lele, who says that do we need to test our domestic help with the RT-PCR? And normally they are very reluctant because they have a fear that they would be quarantined and with a loss of earnings. So I would leave this open to both of you.
Actually, Dr. Ashish, this is a good question, and this is day in, day out issue which is being faced by every one of us, even in our own house, the maid which was who was coming. So we should get them tested with RT-PCR, but in case they are reluctant, or they don't, means if you even advise them and they don't go, then you can have some rapid antigen test kits with you, or like CoviShelf and these type of kits, with which you can at least, if there is any symptomatic patient, or if there is any symptomatic housemaid, then you can take care of the infection if the person is tested. And testing is, I guess, very important, and we have to give importance to testing, and whichever test is available, we have to get it tested.
All right. I think there's also another associated question to this, which is like when people travel in crowded places, they have been using N95 masks and goggles, but is there any other PPE which you recommend for the people traveling in crowded places?
No, as we all know that infection, usually we catch infection through our nose or through our air passages or through the touch mechanism. So we have to somehow protect these two main areas, and we have to cover our eyes also, because because this ACE2 receptors, they are there in eye also, so eye contact eye. So people can catch infection from eye also. So whatever is the source of infection, these are the routes through which infection can go in your body. So we have to take all necessary precautions, like face shield, or wearing goggles, or wearing gloves, especially when you are going in crowded places, or where you are going in public places where you think that there are more chances of infection. So it is your own risk analysis which is important. If you think that this particular PP is important for that, for going or visiting that place, then you should use it, because your risk analysis will only tell you the PP which is recommended for that situation. And moreover, this sanitization, COVID appropriate behaviors, all these things, they are to be there, and vaccination, definitely you have to go for vaccination. If you are eligible beneficiary, you should definitely go for vaccination. No hesitancy should be there, because still in India, a lot of population is still unvaccinated. And one study was shared recently from, I remember which hospital in US, that most of the cases who were admitted in the hospital, 90% they were not vaccinated. Even in ICU, 100% of those cases they were not vaccinated. So it means people who are on ventilator, people who are in hospitals, if we do some study on them, we will find that many of them, they are not vaccinated. So vaccine, they give us lot of coverage, lot of safety against the virus. So we should go for all sort of necessary precautions and vaccination. Dr. Rajiv?
Yeah, interesting question actually. And if you recollect, in previous weeks, we've been talking about this. Open spaces versus closed spaces, ventilated spaces versus unventilated spaces, and fomites versus air. So this is a debate which will always happen for COVID-19. And the current evidence is supporting open spaces should be preferred than closed spaces. Ventilated spaces should be preferred than unventilated spaces. And this is in addition to the mask and frequent hand sanitization. This combination will support travel only when essential. If you are traveling, try to use an open rickshaw or an auto rickshaw, because it is well ventilated all the time. If you have to make a choice between a non-AC car and AC car, use a non-AC car. A bus, non-AC bus is better than AC bus. In the Mumbai suburban, almost all trains are non-AC. But the issue is frequent interaction and the distance between the citizens, that will determine the ultimate transfer. And how much other people are wearing the mask and how much COVID appropriate behavior they are doing, that will determine the outcome. So it's a risky situation. I know from Monday onwards, Mumbai is going to see a new Mumbai. The lifeline of Mumbai is the local trains. And people live through local trains. For the first time after the pandemic, the local trains are being opened for all citizens of Mumbai, provided they have vaccination done and they have negative RT-PCR, either the two. And they can generate the certificate or print out and then enter. So the test will be tomorrow and from Monday onwards. Let's see. Because ultimately, lives and livelihood question will remain. So now the time has come for testing the livelihood. As you must have seen in the epidemiological situation I was mentioning, Mumbai has seen a long period of very low infection transmission. So the time for livelihoods has come. And let's hope, keep our fingers crossed. Again, I would say eternal vigilance. Get yourself tested at the slight test suspicion and follow COVID appropriate behavior 24/7 all the time, everywhere that you go. It is not only the trains, it is the station compound and it is the home to station or office to station that will also determine the infection transmission. So let's keep our fingers crossed.
So this was, I'll just share one JPG image, sir. Can you see this, sir? So is this visible, sir?
It is not completely, only one side is visible.
Okay. Just a
minute. Not even now.
Can you see it now, sir? Now it's visible.
Yes, sir.
So these are the COVID hospitalization on August 11. This is the Houston Healthcare. Out of 84 hospitalized, only 11 were vaccinated and 73 were unvaccinated. And in ICU, only 2 were vaccinated, 24 were unvaccinated. And in ventilator, all of them, 11 out of 11, they were unvaccinated. So it shows that how vaccination will help you in overcoming this COVID pandemic and getting only mild illness rather than going to hospitals or getting admitted in the ICUs. So I think, sir, with this.
So thanks a lot for the elaborate answers. I think this brings us to the end of the session. As we are going across tomorrow into the Independence Day, I want to actually wish everyone a very happy Independence Day. Also, as a mark of respect, can I also ask Shivang, can you please play the national anthem? And I would request everyone to please stand up for the national anthem.
Jana Gana Mana Adhinayaka Jaya Hind Bharat Bhagya Vidhata Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravida Utkala Vanga Vindhya Himachala Yamuna Ganga Uchala Jaladhi Taranga तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तव जय गाथा जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे
thanks everybody. Wish you a very happy Independence Day and a good night.
Thank you. Thank you everyone. Thank you, Dr. Ashish.
Thank you. Thanks.